Thank you for being here today. I'm Kara Griggs, and I've been a reference archivist at the Library of Virginia since 2006. This presentation is a basic guide to African American research in Virginia. The focus is on records at the Library of Virginia, including originals, microforms, publications, subscription databases, and free websites. The focus is on Virginia because records are not always the same in other states. We will stop around 1870 because that is the year that, in theory, the federal census included the names of everyone in the United States, which makes individuals easier to locate. Because I am discussing historical records and the language within them, I will be using some terms, such as free Negro, that we would not use today. I will also note that at this time, the Library of Virginia is open by appointment because of COVID-19. I will begin with an overview of the holdings of the Library of Virginia, which was created in 1823 and is Virginia's state library and state archive. It is an excellent place to start your research because of the many types of records and publications in its holdings. Given the magnitude of the library's collection, please be aware that I can only provide an introduction. As you progress with your research, library staff are available to answer questions and perhaps introduce you to other lesser-known collections and resources. I will start with some of the records that are particularly useful for genealogical research. As the state archive, the library has what you would expect, state records that have been chosen for permanent retention. In addition, many localities choose to store their records at the library or permit the library to have microfilmed copies of them. My one caveat with local records is that when Kentucky became a state in 1792 and West Virginia became a state in 1863, they kept their county records, so the library can only be of limited help if you are researching those states. The Lost Records Locality's digital collection includes records from counties that have lost most of their records because of wars, fires, and natural disasters. When copies of these records are found in personal papers or in the records of other counties, the library indexes and digitizes them. The library also has papers and records of individuals, families, and organizations. As the state library, there's also a large collection of published materials. County histories and abstracts of records are of special importance because they are often a quick way to get through a lot of records. It is much easier to check in every name published index than it is to check a more limited microfilmed index. Special Collections is open on weekday afternoons, and they have prints and photographs, rare books, maps, and architectural drawings. So this is an overview of the Library of Virginia's collections. How do you find what the Library of Virginia has? The For the Public section of the library's website will tell you much of what the library has, particularly the first and third links. Using the collections provides links to pamphlets about types of records, indexes, digital collections, and lists of microfilm. This is also where you can find links to subscription databases. Search the LVA catalog is a link to the library's catalog. Not all government records are included in the catalog, but it is basically comprehensive for state records, private papers, and publications. You can search for individuals, but you may be more successful with subject searches for surnames, such as Carrington family. Because there is no one place to look for information, and much of what the Library of Virginia has is not indexed, it is important to approach the library's collections with names, dates, and localities. Often it is best to ask what type of record will be useful, determine if the library has it, and check to see if there is any kind of index, whether as a part of the record itself or in a separate published, unpublished, or online resource. Coming to the Library of Virginia with as much information as possible is helpful because records at the library are often divided by locality, and statewide indexes may not exist. And different records exist for different time periods. When beginning a research project, start by giving yourself a good foundation. Read a lot of books. read basic genealogy books to get a good grounding in theory, methodology, and how to cite your work, as well as books that are more specific to your research, such as those on African American genealogy and genealogical resources for your state. Read history books too to give yourself an idea of what was going on in the world, country, state, and locality, and think about how those events may have impacted record keeping. When you have a good foundation, it is time to start your research. Start with yourself. Write down what you know about yourself and your family and work backwards. If you start with someone from the past and work forward, you risk discovering that you're researching someone who has your surname but is not actually related to you. Also, do not just go back linearly. Research your ancestors' siblings as well, because their records may provide more information on past generations than the records of your direct ancestors. Ask your family for help and collect all of the information that you can get, because you never know what might be useful in the future. Note localities and dates whenever possible, and do not be afraid to guess. After this preliminary work, start trying to confirm what you have discovered by using records and then focus on getting back to earlier generations. Relevant resources may be in a variety of places, including the Library of Virginia, courthouses, libraries, and historical societies. If you want to be comprehensive, you need to visit as many repositories as possible. Before we start looking at records, I want to note a few dates to provide context. We will look at more as we go, but the following is just a basic framework. The first English colonists arrived in Virginia at Jamestown in 1607. African American research begins in Virginia in August of 1619, when the first recorded Africans arrived at Point Comfort. They were sold and transported to Jamestown. The first known instance of lifetime servitude in Virginia came in 1640, when three indentured servants attempted to escape. The two white servants from Europe were given an additional year of servitude, while John Punch, who was black, was given a lifetime of servitude. By 1662, it was determined that whether a child was enslaved or free depended on the status of his or her mother. This means that slavery became hereditary at this time. The international slavery trade continued in Virginia until 1778, when it became illegal to transport enslaved individuals from Africa into Virginia. The federal government did not end the international slavery trade until 1808. Of course, domestic slavery trade continued, as well as smuggling. Slavery ended with the ratification of the 13th Amendment to the United States Constitution on December 6, 1865. I also want to note again that Virginia's early records are extremely fragmentary and many were lost over time. Much of what we know about early laws is from William Waller Henning's Statutes of Large, which covers 1619 to 1792. The laws through 1732 were cobbled together long after the fact from a variety of sources, including the notes of lawmakers. Therefore, Henning's cannot be considered complete until after Virginia began to print its laws in their entirety in 1733. And the books on the screen are just a list of helpful resources if you are looking for particular laws. I also want to mention some misconceptions concerning surnames. It is often assumed that enslaved individuals only have first names. That is not always true. In fact, even if they were not recognized by the enslaver, generations of an enslaved family could have had a surname. Also, do not assume that a formerly enslaved person took the surname of his or her last enslaver. Sometimes they did, but some took the name of a previous enslaver or a relative or chose an entirely new name. And finally, watch out for changing surnames. Sometimes a formerly enslaved individual took the surname of his or her last enslaver as a form of identification or simply given that name in records. That does not mean that the person could not change his or her surname later. What this means for researching individuals who are known to have been enslaved is that you can start with the assumption that the individual took the name of his or her former enslaver, but remember that that might not have been the case. The key to all further research is determining if the individuals you are researching were enslaved or free, because that information will dictate the direction of your research. Five types of records are particularly easy to access and helpful with making this determination. At this point, I will emphasize that I'm speaking about ideal situations. First, Virginia has lost a lot of records over the years, especially during the Civil War. Second, not every individual will be included in every record that I mention, even if you think that that person should be there. First, check the 1850 and 1860 censuses. If an individual is listed on the population schedule, that individual is almost certainly free. The 1850 census was the first to list by name everyone who was free. Prior to that time, only a head of household was listed, and there was a count of everyone in a household by age, gender, race, and free status. In 1850 and 1860, enslaved individuals were counted on what was called the slave schedule for the census that includes the names of enslavers, but not the names of those who were enslaved. This schedule is separate from the population schedule. If a person does not appear in the census, there is a good chance that he or she was enslaved. Check to see if the Library of Virginia has a cohabitation register for your locality. The proper title for these records is Register of Colored Persons Cohabiting Together as Husband and Wife on 27th February, 1866. Enslaved individuals could not legally marry, but they still formed families. These registers were a way to legalize relationships. The date of February 27th, 1866 is when the Virginia General Assembly enacted the law to compile these records. The registers were created by the Freedmen's Bureau, which I will talk about in more detail shortly, and were placed in courthouses or remain with Freedmen's Bureau records that are now housed at the National Archives. Registers that have been located in Virginia courthouses are digitized on the library's website. Another useful but more obscure record to check is the Register of Children of Colored Persons whose parents had ceased to cohabit on 27th February, 1866. These registers contain the same information as the cohabitation registers, except that they also note whether a child's mother was living or deceased. These records may also be digitized on the Library of Virginia's website. Another way to determine if an individual was enslaved or free is to search free Negro registers. In 1793, a law was enacted that required all free African Americans who resided in towns to be registered in their localities. The process extended to the counties in 1803. The individual received a paper known as a free paper or free Negro certificate or certificate of freedom as evidence of registration. In the absence of free Negro registers, search for free Negro lists. In 1801, a law was passed that required lists of free African Americans to be submitted annually along with lists of taxable property. These are either loose papers like this one or maybe in personal property tax books. Sometimes they can be difficult to find. If a free African American was the head of his or her household, he or she may be in the personal property tax records that begin in 1782. There are numbers for free men and enslaved individuals over the age of 12 or 16, as well as information on livestock and household goods. For the most part, only those who are very poor did not have to pay taxes, and they may still be listed as having an exemption. At this point, you will hopefully know if you are researching an individual who is enslaved or free and be able to choose a research path accordingly. First, we will talk about researching free African Americans. In many ways, this research is no different from any other kind of genealogy. You need to continue to search the census, tax records, and local records like deeds. However, there are some records that are unique to this type of research. The free Negro lists are a good resource to continue to search. You will be able to ensure that the individual you are researching remained in the same locality from year to year and be able to note any changes. Delinquent tax lists may be useful. If a free African American did not pay taxes, he or she could be hired out by the sheriff to pay off the debt. County or city deed and will books may include manumissions. Both records are usually filed under the name of the enslaver rather than under the name of the person who received his or her freedom. As I noted earlier, beginning in 1793 in towns and 1803 in counties, free African Americans had to register with the court and were given a certificate of freedom as proof of registration and free status. Continue to use free Negro registers as you find family members and look for individuals with the surname you are researching in case you later discover they are related to your research subjects. Court order or minute books, which chronicle all of the business that came before the court, from murder trials to requests to record deeds, may also note when an individual came to court to file a registration or to request to have free papers renewed or replaced if they had been lost. If there is no free Negro register for your locality, definitely comb through court order and minute books to see if there are any references to registrations. Some of these books are indexed, some are not, and some may have lists of free African Americans, probably under the heading of free Negroes in their indexes, who are mentioned in these books. Each locality has its own system, so you'll have to look at the books for your locality to see if they contain this type of information. The registration system was more haphazard than one might think. For example, I have found order book references in one county to free papers being renewed, but no reference to an initial registration. In another county, I found that the register contained more than one reference to the same person because he was re-entered into the register when he renewed his certificate. In some cases, the library has free papers for an individual, but I cannot find the individual in an order book. And some people never registered or registered long after they gained their freedom. Unfortunately, this means that tracking individuals is not quite as straightforward as it could be. It may have been up to the clerk in the community as to whether registrations took place as they should have. Here is an example of the registration process, and this is a free paper for Lucy Jarvis Perriman Scott of York County, and I'll read most of it to you. I, Bolivar Shields, clerk of the County of York in the state aforesaid, do hereby certify and make known to all whom it may concern that Lucy Jarvis, the bearer here, is a free person of color, born of free parents in the County of York, and is entitled to all of the benefits of a free person of color under the laws of this state. The said Lucy Jarvis, who was Lucy Perriman and is now Lucy Scott, wife of William Scott, 5 feet 2 inches high, about 47 or 48 years old, mulatto woman, was registered in the presence of the York County Court the 19th day of June, 1848. Who certified the foregoing to be truly and correctly made, given under my hand and seal of office, this 19th day of June, 1848. If she has a free paper, I can expect to find her in a free Negro register. And here she is in the York County Register from June of 1848. The text is a shortened version of the text of Lucy Scott's free paper. But I happen to know that that free paper was from Henrico County Records, not York County Records. So I found her in the Henrico County Register as well. The date is September 5th, 1848. Unlike the York County Register, this register is more of in a chart form. On the second page, it notes that she appeared with a certificate of freedom from York County, and that's what we just saw. Also, this register specifically notes that she has no marks or scars on her face and hands, which was information that was required beginning in 1834. I know that she is in the register, so I also looked for her in the Henrico County Court Order Book. It contains the same information as the register. Interestingly, York County did not record similar information when she recorded her registration there. There is no reference to that event in the order book. In 1806, a law was enacted that made it illegal for an enslaved individual who was manumitted on or after May 1st, 1806 to remain in Virginia for more than a year after he or she was manumitted. If the individual remained for longer than that period of time, he or she could be sold into slavery again. Individuals could petition the General Assembly to remain in Virginia, and a database of these petitions is available on the Library of Virginia's website. Here is an example of a petition for Forrest Griffith, which was signed by 70 people. To determine the outcome of the petition, you can look in the Index to Enrolled Bills of the General Assembly of Virginia by John W. Williams. If the person is included in the index, then the petition is mentioned in the Acts of the Assembly. The published Acts of the Assembly contain the text of the act concerning the individual who was to remain in Virginia. Williams's book will give you numbers for the original enrolled bills, which the Library of Virginia has, but the published versions have their own internal indexes, so you can search for an individual by name. In this case, the General Assembly referred the case back to the local court, so the local court records document the outcome, which was that Forrest Griffith was permitted to remain in Virginia. For this example, the paperwork was still at the courthouse. This is an example of not finding a record when I expected to find it. Forrest Griffith received his freedom prior to 1840, so he should have petitioned in the first year of that freedom. Instead, he waited about a decade. Beginning in 1837, free African Americans could also petition the county court to remain in Virginia. Records of these petitions may be found in the records of county and city courts, and court order and minute books are the first place to look for them. The library may also have case files or judgments regarding these petitions. Simply put, the best way to research an individual who was enslaved is to research the enslaver, because the records that concern the enslaver could contain references to enslaved individuals. Hopefully, you already know the name of the enslaver, or you at least have an idea of who it may be. But even if you do not, there is still hope. With the name of an enslaved person and a probable location, you may be able to find a birth record for an individual in the Bureau of Vital Statistics records, which began in 1853. The law required every commissioner of revenue to make an annual registration of births, marriages, and deaths in his district. Early records are available on FamilySearch as well as on microfilm at the Library of Virginia. FamilySearch is an excellent option because you can find a record by typing a name. The microfilmed indexes are only for births and marriages, and birth records for those who were enslaved are indexed under the name of the enslaver. But certainly, if it is difficult to find someone on FamilySearch, try the microfilmed indexes or even just looking through the entire birth register for a particular locality and year. In addition, there is a published 5-volume set of books called Virginia Slave Births Index, 1853 to 1865 for these records. There is also a 6th volume to that set that lists the enslaver's surnames by locality. Be aware that the name of the baby may not have been recorded, and this is not unique to those who were enslaved. Bear in mind that a lot of birth and death records, especially for the time of the Civil War, are missing. And there is a chance that not every birth and death is documented. That is also true for the free population, but since enslavers had to document the ages of enslaved individuals for tax purposes, you may find that you have more luck in finding a person because he or she was enslaved. Do not overlook the possibility of a database that indexes records. The library has a partial database for its collections and those of the Virginia Museum of History and Culture that is called Virginia Untold, the African American Narrative. You may also be able to find a database that has been created by a locality or other organization too. Unless noted otherwise, these databases may be works in progress and you will have to check back periodically for updates. If an individual was a fugitive from slavery, a newspaper advertisement might provide a description, possible destination, and the name of an enslaver. If all else fails, search the 1850 and 1860 slave schedules of the federal census for the names of enslavers in the area, and especially those who have an individual's last name or who live near your research subject in 1870. But bear in mind that where that individual was living in 1870 might not be in the same place that they were living in 1860 or 1850. And those who were formerly enslaved did not always have the same surname as their former enslaver. Once you have the name of an enslaver or some potential enslavers, you will need to start searching for information about that individual. The records of the enslaver and his or her family will be the key place to gather information on enslaved people. Personal papers may be useful. Family Bibles may contain birth and death information on enslaved individuals. Be aware that even though enslaved people could not officially marry, their marriages could have been recognized by the enslaver. And on that note, remember that enslaved individuals did not always marry someone who lived in the same household. Plantation records and personal correspondence could provide the names of enslaved individuals and provide information on whether they were hired out to someone else who could have included them in their own records. Please note that the library does not contain a collection that is called plantation records. However, if you search the Library of Virginia's catalog for plantation names, family names such as Smith family, or names of individuals to determine if the library has any relevant records. If you can determine the church to which the enslaver belonged, you may want to look for those records because the registers may contain information on enslaved individuals such as births, baptisms, and deaths. Or enslaved individuals may have attended a different African-American church. Local chancery court records may be of help. The Chancery Court was a court of equity that dealt with matters such as dividing estates after someone died intestate, divorces, or disputes over enslaved individuals. The Library of Virginia has digitized case files for many localities in the Chancery Records Index. Personal property taxes are annual for the most part and will provide a minimal amount of information on the number of individuals that someone enslaved. You can track changes in that number from year to year. These are a good supplement to the slave schedules for 1850 and 1860. The slave schedules have more detail, but some tracking by numbers can be done with the tax records. The caveat with these records is that they simply record who paid taxes on enslaved individuals. Enslaved individuals could be hired out to other people who were responsible for paying the tax for them for the amount of time that they were hired. This means that the number of enslaved individuals for enslavers might decrease if they have hired out enslaved individuals and increase for those who may enslave very few or no people. Also, enslaved individuals under a certain age were not counted. If you have worked your way back to the 1770s, county tithable records may reveal the name of an enslaver. This was a tax on free white males, enslaved individuals, and Native American servants, all age 16 or older. Heads of household paid the taxes. Many lists contain only the name of the head of household, but some contain the names of all on whom the tax was paid. You may feel like you are learning more about the enslaver's family than about your research subject, but given that enslaved individuals were regarded as property, references to them, and especially by name, can be difficult to find. You need to work your way through every bit of evidence that you can find about the enslaver's family in the hopes that you will find some reference to the people they enslaved. Let's see how several types of records work together by researching a few of the enslaved individuals in Frederick Leonard's household, which was in Chesterfield County. They were recorded in the census for 1840. The census had names of the heads of households and numbers to represent everyone else in the household. This was the last census to have this format. Enslaved individuals are listed on the second page. From the census, we can learn that he had 9 enslaved individuals of various ages in his household. Next, we need to look at Frederick Leonard's will, which was written in 1845 and proved on February 9, 1846, after he died. From this, we can learn to whom he left enslaved individuals and their names, and hence to what their ages might be. You can see the names in the inventory of Frederick Leonard's estate from June of 1846 as well. So even if only his inventory was recorded, and that is sometimes the case, you can still see the names of the enslaved individuals. So who were they? By the use of boy, girl, and woman, perhaps we can determine some ages based on the 1840 census. This is not very scientific, but it is the best that we can do for now. So we can revise our list of children and enslaved individuals to reflect the ages. Next, we will trace Patty and Susan, who were enslaved by Elizabeth Leonard. According to our calculations, one was born circa 1785 to 1804, and the other was born circa 1816 to 1830. I was able to find Elizabeth Leonard on the tax roll from 1846, the year her father died, and she inherited two enslaved individuals, to 1859. With the exception of 1847, when she was in the same household as her sister and claimed two enslaved individuals, and 1855 and 1859, when she claimed none, Elizabeth Leonard consistently claimed one enslaved person above the age of 16. Despite this, I found her on the 1850 slave schedule with three enslaved individuals, a 45-year-old woman, a 35-year-old woman, and a 5-year-old boy. The women's ages sort of match our calculations. One was born circa 1805, and the other was born circa 1815. And finally, here is Elizabeth Leonard's will, which was written and proved in 1860. She lists, to use the language of the will, a Negro girl, Fanny, a Negro woman, Patty, who is approximately 50 years old, and a Negro woman, Susan, now hired out the present year to James Cobbill, 1860. So it appears that for all of the times that she was claiming one or no enslaved individuals, she actually enslaved two or even three or four, albeit one under the age of 12. And she states specifically that James Cogbill hired one of them. He would almost certainly have been the one paying the taxes, not Elizabeth Leonard. And so we can revise our list. The point of this is to show that numbers on a census or personal property tax record that may not seem to mean much can actually be translated into names and approximate ages when combined with other records. I will also note that these are all public records, so they are more common than elusive personal papers. Although not exclusively, all that I have just referenced refers to records that could be generated while an individual was enslaved by a particular person or that person's estate or business. But what about the records that describe how a person came to be enslaved by an individual, business, or even the government? As we have just seen, it may be as simple as a will. When an individual died, his or her estate had to be transferred to someone else. Wills and accompanying inventories may include the names of enslaved individuals. Be aware, though, that spouses can enslave individuals independently. And if the deceased person's heir was not an adult, you may want to search for guardian records. For example, an individual who was enslaved by a minor might be hired out to support that child, and there would be records of the money that was earned in the guardian records. Sometimes in personal papers or county records, there are loose bills of sale or receipts for an enslaved individual. Those who were bought and sold enslaved people kept detailed records of from whom they purchased enslaved individuals and to whom they sold them, although most of these records do not survive. The Dickinson and Hill example has lists of names that are probably for whom the enslaved individual is being sold, the enslaved person's name, and the name of the person who purchased the enslaved individual. The numbers are likely the enslaved individual's assigned value. Inward and outward bound slave manifests for the domestic slavery trade are included in federal customs records and list the enslaved individuals who were sent from one port to another. In other records that we have seen, enslaved individuals did not have recorded surnames. In this case, As is typical for this type of record, everyone has a recorded surname. The end of the Civil War in April of 1865 brought with it the end of slavery and many records that document how African Americans who were emancipated at the end of the Civil War settled into their new lives. On March 3, 1865, the Bureau of Refugees, Freedmen, and Abandoned Lands, also known as the Freedmen's Bureau, was created by Congress, initially for 1 year. It was based in the Federal War Department and staffed by the military and civilians. The Freedmen's Bureau was in existence until June 10, 1872, when it was abolished by law. The Freedmen's Bureau began its work in Virginia in June of 1865 and ceased most of its operations in Virginia on January 1, 1869. Activities in Virginia, including establishing hospitals and schools, providing rations, supervising the creation of labor contracts between freedmen and planters, and ensuring justice. They also created the cohabitation registers that I mentioned previously. Those in need often welcomed the assistance, but many others responded to the Freedmen's Bureau's efforts with violence. So you can see that these records could include the names of a great many people and may have information on births, deaths, and migrations, and may have lists of names that place an individual in a particular place at a particular time. But do be careful of your research in counties in Northern Virginia, because their earliest Freedmen's Bureau records are in the District of Columbia's field office records, not Virginia's. The Freedmen's Savings and Trust Company, or Freedmen's Bank, was also created by Congress on March 3, 1865. The bank was based in Washington, D.C. and intended for African Americans. It failed in 1874. Despite the similarity of name, it was not connected to the Freedmen's Bureau. Of great importance are the contents of the bank's registers, which include biographical information. For the earliest registers, the names of former enslavers and plantations may be included. Later records contain less information. And here we have the record of Joseph Dean, and his application is fairly early, 1868. You can see that this record provides the name of his former enslaver, Beaufort Brown, and that even though he currently lives in Richmond and was born there, the plantation on which he worked was in Goochland County. Although we do not know the name of his father, his mother was known and living in North Carolina. He also had a brother in New York City, and he was employed as a carpenter. And Joseph Dean served in the 2nd United States Colored Cavalry, which means that he was free prior to the end of the Civil War. Let's look at how some of these post-war records can work together. Cesar Steptoe is included in the Roanoke County Cohabitation Register that I found on the library's website. It indicates that he was 45 years old on February 27, 1866, and was born in Bedford County. He was residing in Roanoke County and was a farmer. His former enslaver was J.H. Smith, who also resided in Roanoke. Cesar Steptoe was married to 40-year-old Laura Kentley, who was born in Botetourt County and living in Roanoke. Her former enslaver was G.W. Carr, who was also of Roanoke. Cesar Steptoe and Laura Kentley began to cohabit in December of 1846. The names and ages of their 7 children are noted on this record as well. Next, I found Cesar Steptoe through the Family Search database of the Freedmen's Bureau Virginia Field Office records and a register of Freedmen's Bureau labor contracts for neighboring Floyd County. He and 2 daughters were hired by G.W. Carr for the year 1866 for $148. The person who hired them appears to be Steptoe's wife's former enslaver. After that, I searched the 1870 census, which told me that Cesar Steptoe lived in Roanoke County with his wife, all of his children who were mentioned in the cohabitation register except for the oldest, another daughter who was born circa 1868, and 3 other individuals. G.W. Carr, for whom Steptoe and his children worked, was recorded on the same page and almost certainly lived nearby. In the case of both the labor contract and the census, if I had not already known about the Steptoe's relationship to the Carr family, this would have been a major clue. And now that we have researched the family of Caesar Steptoe and Laura Kentley forward to 1870, we have enough information to begin to research back into the time that they were enslaved. Laura Kentley and her enslaver, G.W. Carr, were approximately the same age, and I wondered if he had inherited her. So I took a look at the record of his first marriage to find out who his parents were. I discovered that Carr was from Albemarle County, not Roanoke, but his wife, Emma Watts, was from Roanoke, and since Laura Kentley was born in Botetourt, part of which became Roanoke County when she was approximately 12 years old, perhaps she was inherited from the Watts family and not the Carr family. I proved that hypothesis when I found the estate records for Edward Watts that lists Laura Kentley and her children. I was curious as to why Caesar Steptoe was born in Bedford but was living in Roanoke in 1866. I found the 1871 death record of John H. Smith, his former enslaver, and discovered that he was also born in Bedford. It seems possible that Caesar Steptoe moved to Bedford from Bedford to Roanoke whenever John Smith did. African Americans were involved with both the Confederate and Union armies during the Civil War. The Civil War began on April 12, 1861. For all practical purposes, the war ended on April 9, 1865, with the surrender of the Army of Northern Virginia at Appomattox. Following the Emancipation Proclamation of January 1, 1863, that freed enslaved individuals in the areas that were in rebellion against the United States, African Americans could serve in the Union Army. Here are a few cards from a 10th United States Colored Troops service record for Moses Tossell, who enlisted on October 29, 1863, for a term of 3 years. According to the company descriptive book, Moses Tossell was 25 years old, 5 feet 7 inches tall, born in Capeville, Virginia, and was a farmer. Most of the cards that are not pictured here simply say that he was present. While not particularly exciting, we know that he was not in prison or in a hospital, and he wasn't a deserter. We also learn that he mustered out on May 17, 1866. You may also want to check the 1890 census special schedule, surviving soldiers, sailors, and Marines, and widows, etc. This schedule was to be limited to those who are associated with the Union Army. Most of the 1890 census does not survive, but for this special schedule, there are surviving pages for half of Kentucky and the rest of the alphabet, including Virginia and Washington, D.C. And here is an example from Loudoun County. As you can see, the information is very basic. If the veteran was deceased, the widow's name is listed as well. The schedule notes whether an individual was African American by the abbreviation COL for colored, but because not every locality does that, it is often necessary to look at the units that are mentioned and determine if they were African American units. For example, Hiram Price was a private in Company A of the U.S. Colored Troops from May of 1863 to November of 1865. The record also notes that he was a resident of the town of Irene. African Americans were also involved in the Confederate military, often as servants, cooks, or teamsters. Records of their service can sometimes be found in the National Archives compiled military service records. They look the same as the U.S. Colored Troops example that we just saw, except that Confederate records are rarely as complete as Union records. The National Archives unfiled papers and slips belonging to Confederate compiled military service records is a set of service records that were either not filed with the other service records, or it was impossible to determine where these records should have been filed. African Americans, male civilians, and women who served in a variety of capacities are also included in these records. Another source to search when looking for possible service in the Confederate military is the Virginia Regimental Series Index, which provides an index to the books that are in the Virginia Regimental History Series. The books in this series are predominantly unit histories, but they also contain information on the individuals who served in the units. The authors may have identified individuals who do not have compiled military service records. The Virginia General Assembly passed Confederate Pension Acts beginning in 1888. The Act of 1888 provided pensions to Confederate soldiers, sailors, and Marines disabled in action and to the widows of those who were killed in action. The pensions were intended for those who were in dire situations, but subsequent acts broadened the coverage to include all veterans, their widows, and their unmarried or widowed daughters. The acts required that applicants be residents of Virginia and, later, the District of Columbia. An act of assembly from 1924 permitted African Americans to apply for pensions. Some had been enslaved and others had been free during the Civil War, and most of their applications are from 1927 and 1928. According to his pension application, James Hairston was enslaved by Sam Hairston, who took him and several other enslaved individuals to war with him. He was supposed to build breastworks, but when he was regarded as not strong enough for that task, he was given the duty of taking care of the horses. And it is interesting to note that contrary to all of my other examples in this talk, James Hairston is the only one who adopted the surname of his former enslaver. And that brings us to the end of my presentation. I hope that I have been able to provide some new ideas for researching African-American individuals who resided in Virginia. I'm happy to answer any questions that you might have, and my email address is on the screen. And I thank you.